Everyone, and welcome to another episode of Entrepreneur India's Smart Investing Series. I am Shipra, Chief Correspondent with Entrepreneur India, and I will be moderating today's panel. So after holding a very interesting conversation last week on the overall investment strategy that investors should follow during COVID-19, this week's episode is a little more focused on one class, which is gold. And so today we've gathered here to discuss, whether gold is a safe haven investment during COVID-19. So let me start by laying out the ground rules for the attendees. So all attendees will automatically be muted, but we encourage participation. So please drop your questions in the Q&A box that you will see, below your screen. So throughout the presentation, please submit content related questions, and we will spend approximately 15 minutes at the end of the session to answer questions. So please wait for the discussion to end so that we can take questions from you. To open the Q&A box, you can click the Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen. So let's begin with the session, and let me start by introducing our speakers. So we have today with us Ruchi Sankhe, who is Senior Managing Director, Origination and Client Coverage with Waterfield Advisors. Ruchi is a seasoned banker with about 21 years of work experience across institutional and private banking with Citibank India. In addition to that, she has 4 years of experience in Cigna Insurance in the US. So in her last role in Citi, Ruchi was responsible for managing key ultra-high net worth relationships for the bank, and she's also worked as the head of insurance broking in Financial Institutions Group, where she was responsible for developing business credit strategy and delivering business results for this segment for Citi across India. Welcome, Ruchi, and thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here.
Our second speaker is Tarun Birani. He's the founder and CEO of TBNG Capital Advisors, which is a SEBI registered investment advisory and wealth management firm that manages about 300 crore rupees AUM across financial markets. Tarun has more than 25 years of experience in the area of wealth management and financial planning. He's a certified financial planner registered with the Financial Planning Standards Board of India. And prior to setting up TBNG, Tarun has worked with RR Financial Consultants and ILFS in various capacities. Welcome, Tarun. Thank you very much for being here with us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Shipra.
So to begin the conversation, let me start by looking at the gold prices. So we've all seen that since the outbreak of COVID-19 in March, gold prices have shot about 35%, which is quite significant, and has also risen to its all-time high levels of about 57,000 rupees. Now, there is ample historical evidence, in the form of data to show that whenever stock markets, or in fact, whenever the economy goes through a turbulent phase, gold tends to do well. So, Tarun, let me start by asking you, does this trend, does it mean that having gold in one's portfolio can provide a cushion against, heightened market risks and uncertainties, and how?
Sure. So, Shipra, let's first understand what has changed, what has actually changed in last 3-4 months. I think post-COVID and pre-COVID, there has a lot of changes which has actually taken place. We were all talking about globalization before. We are in a phase of de-globalization. Everybody is talking about Atmanirbharta. Every country wants to have their own. There was an abundance of oil available today. There is a huge budget deficit which is happening right now. There is everywhere a lot of government intervention happening in everything we talk. Rise of Asia and China again is one very big point we need to understand, that what has changed in last 4-5 months compared to US supremacy all over. And so all these points sets the context of what has changed post-COVID. And one very important development which has taken place is a negative real interest rate. As we speak right now, what is real interest rate? For simplification, it is nothing but the treasury yields in US. If I take example of US, 10-year treasury yields minus the CPI inflation out there is minus 0.7% as we talk today. So there is a negative real interest rate out there. And we have seen always in an environment in 2011, 2008, whenever there is a negative real interest rate, in that environment, only asset class which does very well and very, very counter cyclical in this environment is gold. So I feel gold has a very important role to play in the environment where we are right now. There is a lot of uncertainty around the second wave of COVID happening. So keeping all this in mind, I feel gold need to be part of investors' portfolio. How much is something we need to look at it from the overall portfolio composition, but or the risk profile of the client, but at least a 10% of the portfolio is something which we recommend our clients to be having in their portfolio. Yeah.
Okay, so you know what you said about how I mean at least 10%, but you know from I mean of course but you know the flip side of this trend, you know this trend that I just said that you know where gold and market move in opposite directions, it also essentially means that the two asset classes are of comparable volatility. And I mean, I'm not saying this, you know, there's ample data to show that even during the 2011, post the 2011 rally, when the markets, you know, went up, gold went in, you know, it just went in a tailspin. So does this mean that, you know, even in the case of gold, if it's a full-fledged investment class in one's portfolio, does it mean that you should rebalance and de-risk your portfolio over time as you might do with equity? Ruchi, why don't you answer that?
Yeah, so actually, I will also go back to basics like Tarun. You know, a gold historically has been considered a hedge for inflation. And as Tarun was just saying, what's happening is that we are seeing a reduction in the, we are seeing negative real estate interest rates now. So the inflation projections in the US are almost about 2%, whereas you can see that Fed has given a guidance for a long period of time that interest rates will stay within at least the short term between 0 to 0.25%, right? So you're getting into an environment where you will see negative interest rates, real interest rates. And that is what gold is usually has a proven correlation with. In fact, on equities, it's not considered a perfect hedge. You know, historically also, the way gold has been used is to reduce the overall, improve the Sharpe ratio or reduce the overall risk on the portfolio. But it's not a perfect match on equities when you look at it. But there's a lot of research that has happened in the past to see how gold has performed when equities, you know, vis-a-vis equities. And in the developed markets, actually, over the last 50 years, and in fact, UBS had also published a research some time back, that on a 5-year window, adding gold actually, or at least over a 8 to 10 year period gave of a 5% allocation gave a good hedge to the portfolio, right? So gold can act as a hedge by reducing the risk of the portfolio. But if you look at a negative correlation with equities, that is not the case. But it will have a negative correlation in terms of interest rates. There's a perfect sort of a hedge, inflation hedge there. So that's how one should view gold. One has to look at gold saying that, okay, it is a tactical kind of allocation into your portfolio. It is not something that you say over a long period of time you will keep and just, you know, sort of accumulate, because you would have seen that actually in the 1990s or you would have probably seen that for long periods of time gold has not moved at all, and then suddenly you will see the move up, right? So, and even in terms of volatility, as you were mentioning, in fact it's a very volatile product, so it has very sharp drawdowns. So that's the reason that you don't want to hold it for a very long period of time, because it will not add too much to your portfolio if you hold it for a long period of time. You can look at it in two ways. If you're looking at it from a yield maximization perspective, then you have to look at it saying that I will add it into my portfolio when there is tactically for an 18 to 24 month period when I see that inflation is going up, and because of that, real interest rates are coming down. That's the reason I want to hold gold, but you don't use it for maximizing the yield on the portfolio. The other reason could be to reduce the risk. As I was mentioning, UBS has also done a study where they've looked at the developed market portfolios, not so much in the emerging market portfolios, but they have seen that it has acted as a hedge, even in those equity perspective, by improving the Sharpe ratio, right? But that is more from a reduction of risk perspective, not necessarily improvement of return perspective. When you look at return, you'll have to have a tactical view on gold. So gold, you have to use from two objectives. Either it's a risk reduction. Yes, pretty good in risk reduction. If you're looking at return maximization, then take a tactical view when you see negative real rate interest rates, because that's when it will move out. It will have a lot of volatility. It won't be a linear move up. So be prepared to handle that volatility. We've seen that in gold prices even recently. It's not been a linear move up. It went up all the way to 2050. And then now it's back at 1940 kind of level. So you have to be prepared to deal with that volatility as well, which is why, in fact, when we've built portfolios for clients, through Waterfield, we've done a staggered entry on gold. We've not done a one-shot entry and say, let's just go up to a certain level of a 5% or 10% holding in your portfolio, but really take an opportunity to stagger this out and have a tactical view, not a very long-term view for investing in gold. That's the view that I have.
Okay. Very interesting, you know. So, but you know, even for what you just said, that even for risk mitigation purposes, one has to include gold in their portfolio. How should an investor actually do that? You know, there's so many gold bonds, there's ETFs, there's funds, and of course, you know, physical form, jewelry, bars, coins. So what, according to you, is the best way to, kind of invest in gold?
Asking a woman, then I can say jewelry the best. But frankly, from a most efficient standpoint, I think a gold ETF is the one which is the best way to enter in. In fact, there is a misnomer in the market, and many clients, in fact, have been reaching out to me in the recent past because, you know, gold has become the flavor of the year, so to say. Obviously, nobody can miss the returns that it's given. It's given a staggering, like, you know, close to almost 38% kind of return. And that really draws a lot of people to looking at seeing whether it's a good place to make quick money, right? So a lot of people have been calling and asking for what are the different ways of investing. And I will say, obviously, ETF is the most efficient way. There are gold mining funds that are available. People confuse that and confuse them, saying that they are getting exposure to gold, but gold mining fund effectively is an equity fund, and actually the variables for an equity fund are very different from a gold fund, because it is basically looking at mining capacity. It's a supply demand game at that point of time, saying, you know, how much is the mining capacity being built up. In fact, they usually trail the gold price movements, because, you know, you may be operating at a pretty high operating capacity, so from that perspective the growth may not be as high as you go forward, but gold prices per se are shooting up. So one should not confuse gold mining funds as getting sort of an investment in the underlying asset. But in my view, gold ETFs is a very efficient, cost efficient way of investing. You also get access to gold at very close to the real levels. And jewelry, of course, is a second way. One should look at some physical gold as well, and to add to that. And I'm sure Tarun has something to add. I can see his, you know, he's itching to add it.
I have a couple of more ideas on that. So as Ruchi shared, in terms of options available for gold investing, we have primarily three options available in India. So first is either you can buy these gold ETFs. Second, the fund of fund option through mutual fund, you can do a lot of maneuvering around that. Second option available is this gold mining funds, as she rightly said, and we have one fund, BlackRock fund, available in India. And we did a very interesting study around the rolling return study of, it has almost a history of 13 years and a 3-year rolling return with a gold ETF in India. So the downside protection on this fund is very low. So on a risk spectrum, it will always be higher. So there is a 4-5% extra downside, as rightly said by Ruchi, that this is gold mining companies, right? So direct equity exposure you are taking, and anything happens in the equity markets, and these companies specifically will have a bearing on the returns of this fund. The third, and this option is something which I really like, is a sovereign gold bond option. And this is one of the very interesting options I feel for investor one should look at right now. So three things which plays out for me in this product is it gives you an annual 2.5% annual coupon apart from the appreciation of the gold prices. It has, if you hold it for maturity for 8 years, it is a completely tax-free product. So that is again an added advantage in this product. Again, it is listed in National Stock Exchange, so it gives you a liquidity also. So tomorrow, if you, but yes, it is subject to the market movement, demand and supply. So discount premium will be something one need to consider. So looking at, and it's a Government of India RBI product. So it again gives you an added comfort that this product will be completely transparent and it's a very low cost product available. So to my mind, I will give Sovereign Gold Bond Fund as the number one option compared to gold if one want to invest. But one need to keep it in mind, this is a longer horizon product. It's an 8 year if you want the tax efficiency to build in your portfolio. But for a liquidity purpose, it will have the liquidity available. But with a pinch of salt, this discount premium, you have to look in the market. But looking at the 2.5% annual coupon, I find it as a very interesting product for our clients. And we are recommending to all our clients.
So, you know, here I have a question on SGPs. You know, what you just said that, I mean, if you have to look at the downsides, they're not very liquid. So basically what it essentially means is that you cannot sell them midway. Yes. So, I mean, so like if I want to look at it this way, so like for instance, in the current scenario, if somebody wanted to book profits, they won't have been able to, their bonds are not maturing around this time. And if you wait till the end of the, you know, the 8 year horizon, well, the market could be anywhere at the end of it. So your profits are essentially, I mean, it's up to luck. So what do you have to say on that?
I actually want to add that, in fact, it's very interesting you pointed that out, because I have a little bit of a differing view than Tarun on the gold bonds, because precisely for the same reason that, you know, liquidity, and secondly, for the reason that we look at it as more as a tactical yield maximization place, do not want to hold it for a long tenor, right? So from that perspective, if I'm trying to look at holding the gold asset in my portfolio for only an 18 to 24 month period, then, and of course, you know, the view is yield maximization here, not risk reduction of the portfolio. If that was the view, then, you know, perhaps he's right, absolutely. Then you would, Tarun, mention that it will be a great thing to hold it for a long tenor. Then you cannot get liquidity in the interim. But, you know, it depends on the investment's view of the client. If the investment view of the client is that I want to hold gold because I can see an appreciation, I want the return of the portfolio on my portfolio, when fixed income is not giving any return at all on the portfolio, gold is giving you a lot better return. So there is no option on, and it becomes a fixed income alternative, really. Then, of course, gold makes sense through an ETF, which is a lot more liquid route. But Tarun is correct. If you're looking at reducing the risk of the portfolio, then you'd want to add it as maybe a gold bond, because you're holding it for a long tenor. And you're saying that, as I mentioned to you, 80% of the time in the developed market survey that was done by UBS, the portfolios actually improved their Sharpe ratios by having at least a 5% allocation to gold, right? So from that perspective, it makes sense to do a gold bond fund, a gold bond. But otherwise, makes sense to do an ETF. So it depends on the horizon. But since my view is more tactical, and that's what the view is for my clients, I don't subscribe to the gold bonds. That's the reason for that.
Right. So one more interesting part, Shipra, I want to share, and we did this again, a study for almost a 15-year rolling study with a multi-asset portfolio, with a debt, equity, and a gold portfolio. And we tried comparing it with a zero, let's say 100% equity portfolio also. So let's say if we look at, and it is all in hindsight, but it is very interesting to share all these observations. So last 10 years, the returns of a, let's say, BSE Sensex is around 7.5% CAGR return BSE Sensex delivered. A portfolio with a 20% gold in the portfolio and 20% debt in the portfolio, and if 60% equity in the portfolio, delivered a 11.5% CAGR in the same period. And from a standard deviation point of view, it has reduced the standard deviation of the portfolio considerably. So as rightly said by Ruchi, it is very important to identify the right suitability for the client, because I have seen normally people go with the flow and there is a lot of herd mentality. Yes, gold is doing well, very well for last 4 months. Let's add gold in the portfolio.
Yeah.
Compared to that, I think if there is a proper suitability and a risk profiling mechanism which has been built in the portfolio, then investor would definitely look at asset allocation in a very different light, because every year the leadership of asset classes is changing. And I have a different point of view. Yes, you need to have some part of the portfolio tactical, but I think the core portfolio again can have different asset classes which reduce the volatility of the portfolio. Mm-hmm. So from that point of view, again, gold really helps in getting you that. At the same time, we need to understand gold is not an income earning asset. So you don't get a dividend, you don't get an interest or anything on gold. So like when you buy equity, you are actually buying a company. That company is economically adding some value and there is a dividend, interest, and all those start generating there. Unlike that, gold is a inflation linked asset. So you will always get returns aligned with inflation over a long period of time. But nevertheless, this reduces the volatility in your portfolio. So you can't put all the money in equity. So from that point of view, a multi-asset portfolio makes much more sense. So investor can get their suitability test done and accordingly can decide on that. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, what you just said that, you people as financial advisors, you know, you look at gold as something that will help to mitigate the, you know, portfolio, volatility. So, in that sense, but still, if you want to have gold in your portfolio, then I want to come back to this question of how much, because if an investor is looking at gold as an investment class, as opposed to, you know, what you just mentioned, then can gold really help achieve financial goals? And if an investor is looking at gold, from that lens, then how much should one have, how much gold should one have ideally in their portfolio?
Yeah, you want to take this, Tarun, or you want me to take it?
Please, Ruchi.
Yeah. So I think that as Tarun was mentioning, in fact, over the last 30 years, from 1981 to about 2001, there was a sort of a return calculated on gold, and gold gave about 8.5% return, CAGR return, in that 30-year period, right? Which was, and inflation in India during that period was around 7%. So frankly, it, as he rightly said, it just barely beats inflation. Whereas Sensex over that 30-year period of time gave about a 14.5% return, right? Mm-hmm. So one, when clients are looking at creating portfolio, they are obviously trying to generate return, right? So over a long period of time, when you're trying to put gold to reduce risk, then you have to look at it as a fixed income alternative, saying that, you know, it's barely beating inflation. So that is more like a debt return product. Mm-hmm. So if you're building portfolio to mitigate risk, then you should have an allocation of about 5% odd in gold. Mm-hmm. Tactically, you can increase that over to get returns, higher returns, right? So at this point of time, for example, our client portfolios are positioned at a 10% allocation to gold, because we believe that it can be a return generator, which will generate returns in excess of what the fixed income markets will deliver. And that's the reason tactically we've moved it up to 10%. But I would not advise, if you're building portfolios for a very long period of time, then a 5% of gold does the same kind of work as a 10% does. The only thing is that it will mitigate risk 5% if you add 5%, but it will also reduce the return. So that's why I would not keep it at a 10% level. I would just keep it at a 5% level if I'm trying to build it as a risk mitigation for a long period of time. And I'll hand it over to Tarun for his comments.
What would you like to add here, Tarun?
So, Shipra, I think we also, because we, whenever we do a financial planning engagement with a client, normally we always tell them gold and silver always should be a part of the portfolio, more from a social requirement point of view. We always try to set that expectation. It's not a wealth creation asset, as rightly said by Ruchi also. So, it's not a wealth creation asset. But at the same time, the benefit of a multi-asset portfolio cannot be ignored. You can't have all the money in equity. And so based on your risk tolerance capability, you need to decide how much money you can keep in high risk asset, medium risk asset, and a low risk asset. So from that point of view, we would put this asset in a medium risk asset. So one need to get his risk profiling done for that, and accordingly can be decided. But at the same time, I think the environment where we are in tactically demands a higher allocation of gold in the portfolio. We have never been a big votary of gold allocation in the portfolio, but things have changed dramatically in last 4-5 months. And that has made us to actually start recommending at least a 10% of the portfolio into gold will actually help you over the next 2 years, because there is a lot of uncertainty which is building in. At the same time, we are in, because if you look at the balance sheets of all the global federal, so US federal, before COVID, it was $6 trillion balance sheet, $4 trillion balance sheet. As we talk, it's a $6 trillion balance sheet, right? So there is a huge expansion. There is a huge flooding of dollars across the globe. And dollars has an inverse correlation with the gold. We are expecting the environment not to be very positive for the dollar in the same current environment. And due to that, gold again makes a lot of sense to be part of the portfolio. Yes.
All right. So now that we're talking about, you know, the types of gold investments one can do, I also want to touch upon digital gold. I mean, it's a new form of, you know, gold investment that has come up in the past 2-3 years. So, I mean, I think it's actually, I don't know, I would like to hear if, you know, what do you think about digital gold? I mean, even companies like Motilal Oswal have come out with their, you know, own products around digital gold. So, you know, what is your view on digital gold, you know, as a way of investing in gold? Tarun, let's start with you.
Yeah. So I would say digital gold, I think the way to buy a gold, as we discussed, there are 3-4 options available. Mm-hmm. So from a convenience point of view, yes, digital gold gives you a buy and sell transactional capability much faster than any other option. But I don't see that as a, like gold ETF also you can buy digitally. So from that point of view, I don't see any reason why it is anyhow different. There are a lot of companies available. I know Paytms of the world all started selling gold.
Yes.
They start giving you allocation into the gold prices today and future. But again, my bet continue to would be a sovereign gold bond fund. If you are looking at a gold right now, go for a SGB. I recommend that.
Yeah, so I mean, essentially, you know, it's digital gold is neither a financial product nor a deposit. I mean, I think it's just a great, I mean, it's an easy way to have access to gold round the clock. I think that's what it is, right? Ruchi, what would you like to add here?
No, I would like to say exactly what Tarun is saying. It's very easy to transact in ETFs as well. So I don't see the added convenience of, you know, the digital gold. And I think just in terms of volumes, the price discovery on ETF will definitely be good. So, I mean, I'm not even worried about the price discovery on ETF. So for all of those reasons, I would rather recommend doing an ETF versus, you know, digital gold.
Okay. I want to take a question here from a viewer. Tarachan Chabaria says that Russia, China, and many European nations are investing in gold. So if the dollar price expected to tumble after November. Who would like to answer this?
No. So I think there are a couple of things Tarun touched upon. What is happening obviously is that the Fed, you know, sort of balance sheet has really gone to actually a $7 trillion size. And in fact, there are numbers floating around that it's going to go all the way up to $10 trillion, right? So this is really negative from a dollar perspective, right? Mm-hmm. That when there is so much of money, that dollars that are available, obviously when the supply is higher, you will see the dollar index coming off. And that's one of the biggest elephant in the room, that, you know, how much will dollar depreciate over a period of time? And as Tarun rightly mentioned, that gold has many sort of, you know, I mean, it is such a well-studied product over the last so many years. There have been correlation analysis that have been done across various types of asset categories, right? Mm-hmm. So equity, as I mentioned, it's not a perfect match for real estate, real interest rates. For that, it is quite a perfect match because it's negatively correlated. Even from a dollar perspective, it has a negative correlation. So when dollar weakens, actually gold strengthens. And that's the expectation. When dollar will weaken, gold will appreciate. In fact, today, if you look at a lot of the research firms around, they started out with an outlook saying that gold will go between 2000 to 2200 levels. And in fact, the street consensus, the market consensus is 2200. Just recently, I think 2 weeks ago, Goldman raised it to $2,300, right? There are outrageous sort of like Chris Woods has come out with some level of 5,500, which is completely outrageous. But there are a lot, most of them are thinking that gold will go up for the reasons that we've mentioned, that interest rates are at a low and there are not many too many alternatives to invest. Dollar is going to depreciate because there's just too much of dollar sloshing around. There is no way for it to strengthen from here onwards, right? So all of those things will lead to actually an increase in the gold price. The only thing is it'll go up and go down and go up and go down. So it's not going to be it's going to be a roller coaster ride to reach that level. That's what it is. And you hope to get the bottom and not the high, not the high. But nobody knows how that is. So I don't know. I mean, his question was on Russia, and what was the specific question? I know dollar is weakening is definitely a point that I wanted to make. But
yes. So Russia, China, and many European nations are investing in gold. So is the dollar price expected to tumble after November?
So that's good, right? If they're investing in gold, that's also probably picking up. See, what's happening is gold also, there are three main drivers of demand of gold, right? 50% of the gold actually is used for consumption. And that's India and China that contribute to that consumption demand for gold. Almost about 30% of its investment demand, and a lot of central banks buy it as reserve currency as well, right? So them buying as reserve currency is actually to protect itself from the dollar depreciating. Because so there are two things: you can actually hold a dollar as a reserve currency for the bank, or you could hold gold reserves. And at times you may, if you see that the way forward for dollar is going to be a depreciation, then you'd rather hold gold in reserves. And that's what is also happening. But that's also a reason for worry. Many, if the central banks come out and start selling gold, then actually gold will start tumbling. And that's one of the big worries that is there as well. And that's the reason you see volatility, because there can be big moves in gold. But and consumption demand is very soft. India and China are not necessarily consuming right now, because that's a direct reason. It's a COVID impact. And of course, India has come out and said that, they're looking at revising the excise duty also, maybe downwards to promote this. But consumption has to pick up. Consumption has not picked up. And investment at the same time is being driven largely by the central banks right now and investors. The gold ETFs year to date have seen $90 billion of inflows. That's a very large inflow in ETFs. So all the investors are driving the price of gold, and so are the central banks this time, and not so much consumption demand for this year.
True. Which is essentially the next question also. I mean, you kind of answered it, but I'll still take it up. And Antar, maybe you can answer it this time. Gold prices have already come down from the 57,000 peak to 52,000. So till what duration do you see gold price might increase in the future, especially with the festive season around, and what could be the possible value of it?
Yeah, so I think, Shipra, I think astrologers can...
I know.
I think I will not be in a right to talk about, even I don't know it is 52 today. But I think on a ballpark basis, a couple of points which Ruchi mentioned, I want to add. So if you look at last 10-year growth of gold production is just 1%. So the production is actually, there is no supply happening of gold. So there is a limited supply available for gold. And if you look at all gold mining companies' reserves also, they are reducing as we speak today. At the same time, the central government's demand for gold, and there is one very interesting statistics I want to share. So at the peak level, it used to be the Fed used to have 25% of its reserves available in gold. As we speak, that reserve has come down to 6% today. So that again makes a very strong case that central banks, instead of selling, will have to buy more. So buying more gold is something which will be, as an option, will be used by central banks in future. So again, that again makes a very strong case that the gold prices will continue to remain high only in the environment we are in right now. Yeah.
All right. Okay, so we'll take one more question from our viewer. This can be the last question. So this gentleman wants to know, so for the long-term investment perspective, which is a better gold investment tool between SGBs and ETF, considering that SGB has various investment criteria and lock-in period?
So Ruchi, I'll take this question. So from a long-term point of view, definitely I will rate SGB as a better asset class due to the taxation benefit available, annual coupon available of 2.5% additional apart from price appreciation, depreciation. So SGB is definitely my choice for that.
Okay, because he's added that, you know, there are various investment criteria and lock-in period that comes in with SGB. So, I mean...
Various investment?
Criteria. I am not
sure. I think only individuals can invest, corporates cannot invest.
Yeah, cannot, one. Yes,
and so I think what he's trying to say is that because of the restrictions, does it make sense? Mm-hmm. So wherever you can't, I guess if you can't get access to it as in, and you can mm-hmm. only do it in an individual name, and if you want to do it through LLP or company route, then you would have to do an ETF versus SGB.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so I mean, our time is pretty much up. So I'm going to wind up the conversation here. Thank you very much again, Ruchi and Tarun, for joining us today. And we had a really interesting conversation around gold investments. And thank you very much to all our attendees for taking out the time to hear us. And have a good day, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting us.
Thank you, Ruchi.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.